Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Praise the Lord. Welcome to Father's Arms Fellowship Sunday night, feasting on the Word. We're going to sing and praise the Lord. We are down here. There is a bunch of us down here tonight. I don't know. I'm telling you, they just come out of the woodwork like termites.
Lots of food.
I'm telling you, if you're starving, or even if just a little bit hungry, we got tons of food down here. Get down there. Jump in your car and just run down your fest can and eat and sit and sing and fellowship and get into the Word with us. We're going to have a good time here tonight. In Jesus' name, praise the Lord. Where two or more are gathered in His name, there I am in the midst of you. You know where things happen? When the people of God get together. When the man at the gate beautiful was healed, he went to the house of God and he got his healing. Hallelujah. People get saved in the house of God. They get blessed in the house of God. They get encouraged in the house of God. And the Lord says that when we're gathered together in His name, that we're to encourage and exhort one another unto good works. So that's what we're here to do. And we're going to sing to Jesus tonight. And I've had a couple of requests. So if you know this song, take a bite of food, sing a couple lyrics, and then go back to chewing. Those of you that are out there in Facebook land, just put your food down for a minute if you're eating and sing with us. You know what it's all about? It's all about the blood. The blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus has given us the victory. Amen. By His stripes we are healed. The blood has done so many things for us. We're going to sing about it.
Sweeter as
days go by. It's sweeter as moments fly. It's richer, deeper, fuller, sweeter. Sweeter, 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 sweeter as the days go by. It gets sweeter, Jesus, as the days go by. It gets sweeter. Deeper, fuller, sweeter, 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 sweeter as the days go by. One more time, you get sweeter, Lord, as the days go by. You get sweeter as the moments fly. You get richer, deeper, fuller. Sweeter, sweeter, sweeter as the days go by. Sweeter, sweeter, sweeter. Sweeter, sweeter, sweeter. Sweeter, sweeter, sweeter as the days go by. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Bless the Lord. Andre Crouch wrote a song way back in the day. We used to sing this a lot in the 70s. But it's so powerful. Just such a powerful song. Who gets the glory? God gets the glory. And He deserves the praise. We need to praise Him.
Loving now.
Bibles ready. Receive heart, soul, mind, and strength, Lord. Let us hear your word and worship you. Trust you. In Jesus' name. Bless our brother.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank
you, Jesus.
I don't know. There's just something about Sunday night that just trips my trigger.
Trip it, brother.
Far out, Pastor Ken, man. I mean, I'm just sitting there. I think, you know, we are more like family than we realize.
Yes, sir.
And now, our Sunday nights, did you spell that, Miles? Did he spill his? I think he knocked the soda away. Is there anything? Did he spill anything?
No.
Okay.
It's empty.
Yeah. You have you drink her all up?
He might need some more.
No, he doesn't. And he's coming to your house, sister.
He'll be with the rest of them.
Yeah. Look at all these people here.
Anyway, there is something about Sunday nights, and now, I mean, as big, say we're like family. Now we're starting to read each other's minds when it comes to food. And tonight is salad night at Father's Art Fellowship. And I mean, it's just amazing how soup, salad, sandwich night. It's amazing how we're starting to think alike, which is a little bit scary on one hand. But on the other hand, too, it's neat. And there's something special about these Sunday nights. It's a lot more open, and it's a lot more user friendly, and it's just family. And I just appreciate y'all so much coming, and I hope that the word that comes tonight will glorify God and honor you, and maybe teach you a little something too. That's the whole point of feasting on the word, and it's just working, and I just praise the Lord for that. And so we get some very practical principles in our faith that works, one of the biggest principles that we learn in this is how we treat other people. And I am not a big survey fan, especially church surveys. I don't know. There's just something about them that just, you know, you can skewer the data long enough to make it sound right. You know what I mean? But there are some surveys that show that the number one reason visitors return to a church is because they feel welcome. At every church, and this is a definite true statement from Tommy Heidel, he says, every church thinks it's friendly because its members are friendly to their friends. However, being friendly to the same people at church every Sunday forms a clique.
Come on.
In reality, few churches are really friendly. And man, I mean, that is a stab in the back to many. But it is so true. And I have to be honest with you, I've been on both sides of the fence on this. And as I'm growing more in my faith, as I'm just starting to see some things happening, it just bothers me. And so I hope tonight that we see from the scripture the folly of favoritism.
Yes, sir.
All right. So let's go to the Lord in prayer and begin, and then we'll go for there. Father, just open up this word to us tonight.
Yes, Jesus.
And just fill us with your spirit, Lord, and let us grab something from this and grow in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 All right. Who's ready?
Oh, yeah.
All right, here we go. Maybe.
Chapter 2. My brethren, do not hold the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with partiality.
Amen.
For if there should come into your assembly a man with gold rings and fine apparel, and there should also come in a poor man in filthy clothes, and you pay attention to the one wearing the fine clothes, and say to him, you sit here in a good place, and say to the poor man, you stand there or sit here at my footstool, have you not shown partiality among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts?
Come on.
Listen, my beloved brethren. Has God not chosen the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Do not the rich oppress you and drag you into the courts? Do they not blaspheme that noble name by which you are called? If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you do well. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors.
Amen.
For whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in one point, he is guilty of all. For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. Now if you do not commit adultery, but you do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so do as those who will be judged by the law of liberty. For judgment is without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment.
Amen.
What does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, but you do not give them the things which are needed to the body, what does it profit? Thus also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that there is one God, you do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. But do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son on the altar? Do you see that faith was working together with his works, and by works faith was made perfect? And the scripture was fulfilled which says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. And he was called the friend of God. You see then that a man is justified by works, and not by faith only. Likewise, was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works, when she received the messengers and sent them out another way? For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also.
All right, and we will get into that here in a week or two. Man, that's powerful stuff. Well, there's really four things that from this passage of scripture that kind of explains what the folly of favoritism is. And so we'll be in the first one, which is favoritism is snobbish.
Uh-huh.
So James writes, my brothers, as believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, don't show favoritism. Now, I'm not quite sure what scripture version that is, but that's okay. But But it basically, favoritism is acting like a snob.
Yep.
A snob is someone who wants to associate with people of wealth or social position, or has contempt for those he considers his inferiors. Now, I've seen it both ways. I think, honestly, the worst ones are the ones who are just snobbish and consider people not like them inferior to them. And right now, I'm really struggling with Christians, especially those behind the pulpit. And it seems like lately, and of course YouTube is the worst example, or at least that's where I'm getting most of my information from, unfortunately. But I get some different religious writings and stuff from people, and it's like it's almost as if you don't believe exactly the way one person believes, then you're not saved at all. Or you're basically preaching blasphemy because you don't believe the way I believe. And I come from a Baptist background, and I mean, I'm pretty open about it, and where we came from, in the upper echelons, there's a lot of snobbery. But we're not alone by,
No, you're not.
Not by any means.
No.
There are just as many charismatic snobs, as many Pentecostal snobs, as Lutheran snobs. I mean, it's just everywhere. And this morning I was watching, I attempted to watch, I couldn't watch it anymore. This guy who was basically, his preaching was the three prophets you need to avoid in 2023. And he started quoting, he wouldn't give the names, or at least he probably would have if I would have watched the whole thing, but there was no way I was watching that crap. I'm sorry, I just wasn't. You know, he was sincere, and he probably had scripture to back him up. But the point is, in the late Nancy Missler's office, she had a plaque, and here's what it said. In the essentials, unity.
Amen.
In the non-essentials, liberty. But in all things, agape.
Sure. Yes, Lord.
And I have a message, and I taught it here on Sunday night, and I may bring it up again sometime down the road. The six things we all need to believe in. And the bottom line is, as followers of Jesus, we pretty much all believe these six things. All right? And the rest is open to interpretation. But if we believe in these six things, then there should be enough liberty and freedom to believe for those who speak in tongues versus those who don't, to those who, thrive on the prophetic and those who don't. And instead of ripping each other to shreds, we need to be unified. And that's one of the things that the devil has us doing right now. He has us divided. And that's why we're weak as a body, is because we're divided. On Thursday nights, we meet at Rick and Robin Drawn's house, and we're about as different can be, aren't we? We are. But the one thing that unifies us is that Jesus is Lord and He's coming soon.
Yes.
And the rest, we're just, if our brother Carl Parker says something, I'm just like, dude, I have no idea what you're talking about. And he's like, that's okay, brother. And there's just something really special about that. The fact that we can express our opinion without judgment.
Amen.
We are. But the thing about it is, the thing that excites me is we're more unified than we are different, and we don't share many opinions. But we share a lot of truth about Scripture and different things. And that's why I like about it. And that's why I like about this too. Because, I mean, let's face it, we are a unique group of people in this Sunday night service.
Amen.
Would you agree with that?
Yes, sir.
But yet we are unified in the fact that Jesus is Lord and our Savior, and we want to know more about
Amen.
Him.
Amen.
And so James illustrates this snobbery by telling a hypothetical story of two strangers arriving at a church at the same time. One of them is wearing a gold ring and fine clothes. Now, you got to understand who the audience that James, the half-brother of Jesus, was talking to. He was talking to Jews, all right, who, first of all, hadn't quite figured out that they weren't all that in a bag of chips. Yes, God gave them the law. Yes, they're God's chosen people. That's a fact. But just because that's a fact, it doesn't mean you act like you're all that.
That's right.
And so, I mean, he's addressing the 12 tribes who had, and by this time, are being dispersed everywhere because of Roman oppression. And it was really, they're not sure really when it was written. It had to be written before the year AD 62 because that's when James was killed. So many think that this scripture was written early, sometime after his conversion. Remember, he did not believe in his own brother till after the resurrection. So I mean, he'd heard it all his life, didn't believe a word of it until he saw Jesus come back from the dead. I mean, when he looked at him face to face, I think that was a pretty good indicator he was right. So anyway, this is who James is addressing this to. And so if in the Jewish culture, even in culture everywhere, if you have a lot of money or, you know, you're famous or whatever that is, or you wear finer clothes, people tend to be drawn to that. Now, Madison Avenue hasn't helped things because, you know, they want you to buy the bigger, the better, and the best. You know, no matter how long you have to pay for it. I was looking at new cars. I don't want to buy one, but there was watching YouTube or something like that, and this commercial came up. 84-month car loans.
Wow.
7 years?
Is that seven?
Yeah.
Man.
Dang. It wouldn't be any good.
No.
Mine would be broken down by then.
Yes. Well, you know, you got to change the oil every now and then, kid. Just saying, brother. You know, you got to maintain the car, brother. I'm just saying, you know. Yeah, and I'm just like, but... You know, Madison Avenue is real good about talking you into buying these things on credit, which it's crazy, you know. So he, this gentleman comes in and he has expensive jewelry and a newly pressed, you know, $1,000 to $3,000 suit. All right, first of all. If somebody walked in this church like that, we'd all be going, "What you talking about, Willis?" You know, dude, you are way overdressed in this place. But the thing about it is, James is not criticizing this guy for being dressed up. Not at all. As a matter of fact, what he's pointing out is the snobbery.
Yeah.
Because you see, the second guy that comes in is a poor man in shabby clothes. His clothes are shabby or vile, depending on your version, which means dirty and cheap. So one thing I have to say about this body of believers, you know, when people come to our services, we need to look at them as God does.
That's right.
And how does God look at it? Well, let's look at 1 Samuel. But Abner said to Samuel, "Do not look at his appearance or his stature, because I've already refused him. For he does not see a man as a man sees, for a man looks at the outward appearance, but Adonai looks into the heart."
Yes.
So James says, he tells the usher, "Hey, you come to the good seat." And you know, in other words, he brings him right up front. Now remember, in Jewish culture, the closer you sat to the pulpit, the more influential you were. Okay, it's not like us back row Baptists, you know, who got to sit in the back row because that's our special seat. You know, the seats where our butt prints are permanently engraved in them, you know, and that's not in that culture. If you were wealthy or you had influence or you were a religious person, you sat in the front. And basically, the whole idea was, look at me, look at me. Okay? So, you know, in other words, he's talking about taking the rich guy to the choicest seat in the front of the church. But to the poor man, he says, you stand there or sit on the floor by my feet. In other words, you know, you go to the cootie section of church.
Yeah, that's right.
And, you know, where you can't be seen. And God's word evaluates this behavior by this question. James asks this question. Have you not discriminated among yourselves? Now, we don't know who this wealthy guy is. I mean, he could have got his money for being a drug dealer or a pimp.
Right.
Okay. But the bottom line is, you know, we can't forget the truth that we find in Galatians chapter 3, beginning in verse 28, where it says, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you were all what? One in Messiah Yeshua, okay? Yes. And if you belong to Messiah, then you are Abraham's seed, heirs according to the promise. So guess what? It don't matter if you have a $1,000 suit or you're just wearing holy blue jeans.
Yep.
If you're Messiah Jesus, you're the same.
That's right.
Heirs to the promise. And by judging people based on social class, we become judges with evil thoughts according to verse 4 there in James 2. So now, if a judge in a court of law were to make his decision based on how people were dressed, rather than the facts, everyone would agree such a judge was evil and his decision was a gross miscarriage of justice. Guess what? If you have money nowadays, you can pretty much buy your way out of a trial. So are we seeing a miscarriage of justice or a two-tier justice system? Yes. But there's one judge that everyone has to answer to.
Yep.
Yes, sir.
And you can't buy your way out of that, praise God.
No,
see, it's no less evil for us as believers to base our treatment on people based on such superficial things as dress, economic status, sex, education, or race. Okay? We're all the same if we have Jesus as our
Savior. Amen.
We are all the same. Not worthy, except for the blood.
Amen.
All right, so favoritism is snobbish, and then it's silly. In this case, James, you know, if he hasn't convinced you already of the folly of this favoritism, he says, listen, my dear brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom of kingdom he promised to those who love him, but you have insulted the poor. It doesn't mean that God is partial towards the poor. How do I know? Well, look at Romans 2, verse 11. For there is no partiality with God.
Amen.
But you know what? Usually, though, poor people are more open to the gospel than rich
people.
That's
true. Mm-hmm. That's true.
It is true. Usually the more a person has, whether it be money, education, or status, the more self-sufficient that person feels and the more difficult to see his need for Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so true.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I mean, it was true in Jesus' time, and it's still true today. And even today, the more prosperous we become, the more we drift away from God. And that's a shame. That's a shame.
Mm-hmm.
To further show how irrational favoritism is, James asks three questions. And these are good, hardcore questions. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? See, in Jesus' day, and in James' day, many of the rich and powerful were the Sadducees who were persecuting the church. All right, let me give you a little illustration. There's the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Let me put this to you in modern terms, and I know I shared this with some of you before. The Pharisees were the conservatives. The Sadducees were the liberals. The Pharisees believed in the supernatural. The Sadducees didn't believe in any of that stuff. That's why they were sad, you see. All right. Let's put it in modern terms, okay? Liberal versus conservative. Right now, and it's unfortunately it's true, the liberals are running everything. They've been running it for a long time. Let's cut to the chase. It's Satan that has the control.
That's true.
Okay? They're just pawns. Because there are many conservatives who are just as liberal as the liberals. And then there are some liberals who are conservative, but they're too afraid because they put the money and the position over their hearts. And that is unfortunate.
That is a fact.
It is unfortunate. Okay? But in that day, it was the liberals, just like today, who were persecuting the church.
Yep.
Okay? The Sadducees were persecuting the church. Because it went against everything they believed in. How dare you believe in a God you can't see? You know, how dare you trust Jesus for your soul? I can handle your soul. You know, I can take care of you. You know, depend on the government. And I mean, we can go on. This isn't a MAGA versus non-MAGA thing, okay? It's Bible versus no Bible.
Right.
And that's what's going on. But when you look at the scripture, this is all supposed to happen. Because if it didn't, why in the world would Jesus want to come back? Right? If we didn't need Jesus, why in the world would we be worshiping him? Right? So this is all a part of Satan's plan. And he knows the end of the book, probably better than we do. He knows he loses. But he's still going to go through with it anyway, unfortunately. So we've got to be careful. We've got to be careful with what we do in our politics, in our churches, when it comes to people of wealth versus not wealth. Like I said, I have not seen this year. That's one reason why we love it so much. We're all the same here. But we have to admit it. Most of us have been in a church situation where the ones with money got the preferential treatment.
Yeah.
And ended up causing great harm to the family of believers as a whole.
Yes.
And that is unfortunate.
Yes, it is.
It is so unfortunate. But God's got enough crazy believers here. We just ain't going to put up with that. No,
amen.
We're just not
going
to put up with that.
We don't got time for that.
We don't. Right. We don't got time for that.
Nobody got time for that.
Question number two. Are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? In the New Testament times, if you were poor and you needed a loan, you would often borrow from a rich person with interest rates up to 50%.
Wow.
I mean, you know, payday loans ain't got nothing on them.
Right.
So, you know, this is not a new phenomenon. That's what people don't get to understand. It's almost like all these writers and stuff are like, oh man, these payday loan people, well, they're just crooks. And, you know, this has never happened before. Yes, it has. It's been happening since It's been happening since the Old Testament times. Yeah, exactly, exactly. And we're going to get to that. But I mean, this none of what we're dealing with here is new. It may be new to us, but it's not new. God, you know, God, he knows how stupid we are, right? But, you know, if at that time, if you didn't pay your loan on time, they could legally, okay, take the man, his wife, and his children to be sold as slaves, possibly separating them so they'd never see each other again. Now, the Jews did this even though, according to Exodus 22:25, which you brought out, they could not charge interest to fellow Jews. Now, the one thing about our Muslim brothers and sisters, they follow that now. If you borrow from a brother, they are not allowed to charge interest. Okay. You know, we can learn some things. Mm-hmm. So they were also violating a principle that you find in Proverbs 14, verse 31. The one who oppresses the poor shows contempt for his maker, but whoever is kind to the needy honors
him. Amen.
Amen.
That man.
I'm going to honor you, Lord.
Yes, we are. Amen. Okay, here's a good question. Are they not the ones who are slandering the noble name of him to whom you belong? In other words, by doing what they're doing, are they slandering the name of Jesus? And you're saying this is cool? Then you're just as dumb as they are. If you're allowing this. Now, this could also refer to a Sadducee who fiercely opposed Jesus, to the Sadducees who fiercely opposed Jesus while he was on earth and slandered and persecuted the early church. Now, the Pharisees were just as guilty, but the Sadducees took it to a whole new level, almost like what we're seeing today. Mm-hmm. So it's nothing new. So we've got to be really careful to those who are rich or are poor. That's why we need to be in our word, and that's why we need to be focused on Jesus and let him direct us in what we're supposed to do.
Amen.
So we've already determined that favoritism is snobbish and silly, and here's one, sinful.
Yes, sir.
James continues, if you really keep the royal law found in the scripture, love your neighbor as yourselves, you are doing right. Basically, what showing favoritism does is it breaks the royal law, which is the supreme law governing human relationships.
Yes.
Love your neighbor as yourselves. Okay, look at Galatians 5, verse 14. For the whole Torah can be summed up in a single saying, love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law, by the law as lawbreakers. Now, we all know that if we've broken one of the commandments, we've broken them all. We know this, okay?
Yes.
But showing favoritism to the elite, disdain for the poor, is not just a lack of courtesy. It breaks the second commandment. When I got to the last church I pastored, when we got there, we met this family who had just moved into town. And they came, they brought their four kids to Vacation Bible School. That was the year that we kissed a pig.
I don't know what that means.
We kissed a pig, a real live pig.
You literally kissed a pig.
Right on the snout, both of us.
Pictures.
We have pictures. You know. But. They washed them off the best they could. The pig did the school pig. I'm sorry. But anyway, this family came. And Steve was an alcoholic. and he knew he was in trouble. But I think he told us one time that I just want to stop drinking as much as I am and just drink a little bit. But they were regular church members. I mean, they came when a lot of the other folks would miss occasionally, or sometimes a lot. And Steve and I got to be real good friends. And we found this program called Reformers Unanimous. It is a fundamental Baptist addiction program. Really, it's pretty good. And I started taking Steve to the Reformers Unanimous meeting in Lincoln on Friday nights. Now, because Steve and Deb were, they were poor, he worked till he got hurt. But they didn't make the wisest choices. I mean, we all go through this. Nobody does. I mean, they were poor. And because Steve was, you know, an alcoholic and he didn't do things the way the leadership thought he should, he was looked down quite a bit. But we started taking him to Reformers Unanimous. And we got the opportunity to go to the Reformers Unanimous yearly meeting in Brockford. Now, if you don't know too much about Fundamental Baptist, they're King James only. Women, you got to wear dresses. Men, you got to wear suits. Very legalistic. But the program was really good. Now, I talked to my deacon board for 6 months about going to this thing. 3 weeks or 2 weeks before, God provided exactly the dollars we needed to go. And Deacon Moore comes up to me and says, "We didn't tell you you could go to this."
Oh,
it gets better. But I went anyway.
Good.
And of course, when we got up there, I mean, the first thing, the thing comes on the screen, King James only. Yay! I'm sitting there thinking, well, I brought my king. You know, my thought is, hey, listen, when I'm in your dojo, I'll follow your rules.
Right.
No, I have no problem. But when you're in my dojo, you follow my rules.
Yes.
That's only fair.
Amen.
So I went with it, and a couple of the other guys from the Reformers Unanimous group that we became pretty good friends with, they came, and they made big time fun of me because I had my Jack Van Impe King James Version Bible. Oh, they made fun of me. Not maliciously. I mean, we had a good time. But when I got back, we were fully intent on starting a chapter. Now, the Reformers Unanimous group did not want Southern Baptist in because we're not King James only.
Yeah.
That was their, and you know, we want to keep this thing pure. I'm sitting there thinking, you got a bunch of drug addicts and you want to keep this pure. Think about this for a second. Now, you got a program that can save the world, but you're worried about your stinking Bible version. But that's another story. I was willing to go with that. I don't care. You know, I just want to see alcoholics saved.
Amen.
And drug addicts saved. And the Lord showed me. You know, when I was up there the one night I was laid in bed the first night and I was just broken. And I'm like, Lord, I'll take the stripes if I have to. And I did. But the Lord told me, He says, if it's not this one, there will be something better for Steve down the road. So we present this thing to our deacon board. And the one deacon who should have known the better, because you see, his first wife left him for the town drunk. The one person that should have known better looked me straight in the eye and says, we don't want those people in this church.
Wow.
And I'm just like, oh my gosh.
And set up a wall against
that. Well, at that point, you know, naturally I was devastated. But as a result, Steve and Debbie became, after a series of very bad decisions on their part, okay, they ended up becoming homeless. They left for another church, which at that point, God told me to let them go, and I did. But there was this program there called Celebrate Recovery.
Hallelujah.
And Steve got involved. And ended up becoming a, not a national leader, but right underneath it. And God got his greatest, I don't want to say revenge, but now Steve is the pastor of the church that I was pastor.
Now both people are pastors.
And I was, you know, our job there was to keep plowing the weeds, take the sharp knives till those people died off or left. And I mean, it was hard. It was so hard. I mean, I still have issues with PTSD as a result of that. But praise God that I did the job that God wanted us to do.
Amen.
And now Steve's the pastor of that church.
That's awesome.
And it is awesome.
Hallelujah.
But when you do that, James says this. He says, for whoever keeps the whole law yet stumbles at one point is guilty of breaking all of it. For he said, for he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. If you do not commit adultery, but you do commit murder, you become a lawbreaker. Listen, no matter what, we're breaking God's law. Now, we're free from the law, but the bottom line is, if we break one commandment, we're breaking them all. And the reason that God gave those commandments is because he knew we couldn't keep any of them. That's why we needed the grace and the blood of Jesus. And see, and that's why, you know, it should not matter what version of the Bible you use. Now, I get it why some people are just real anal on some of this stuff. But man, if you start looking at other versions and you put them side by side, you might actually learn something,
darn
it.
That's right.
You know? The God who told us not to commit adultery or murder is the same God who gave us that law. Love your neighbor as yourselves.
Amen.
The bottom line is, we only believe as much of the Bible as we practice. And if we fail to obey the second most important commandment in the Bible, what does it say about our real convictions concerning the rest of God's Word and our love for Jesus Christ? Look what John chapter 14, verse 23 says. Yeshua answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our dwelling in him. Now, here's the cool thing about it. I don't think I've ever seen a person who got saved all of a sudden became it. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I've seen immediate change lives, but it's getting in your word and studying your word and being in groups like this around fellowship, just learning and talking and going through experiences. That's how we grow in our faith. The Jews, on the other hand, you know, it was all about the symbolism and all that other stuff. It's unfortunate, but one day, they will cry out to Jesus to come save them. And he will.
Yes, he will.
He will.
Thank you, Lord.
So favoritism is snobbish, it's silly and sinful, and it's short-sighted. James concludes this discussion with a solemn warning about the short-sightedness of favoritism. Speak and act. In verse 12 of chapter 2, speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom. As you know, as believers in Jesus, we are saved by grace through faith, according to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. But we are going to be judged by the law. While we're not going to be condemned, according to Romans 8, verse 1, we're going to be judged. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Messiah, so that each one may receive what is due for the things he did while in the body, whether good or bad.
Yeah.
In other words, that's called the Bema seat. As believers, we're going to be judged for our works based on what we did with our salvation. It doesn't mean that we're going to hell, folks. Jesus, when he died on the cross and we accepted that gift, it was once and for all, it's solid. He delivered us from that.
Amen.
But we are going to be judged for what we do based on what we do with our faith. That's why James goes through all this faith and works and all this other stuff, which we'll get into. The first judgment is going to be for believers. That's the Bema Seat. The other one is the great white throne judgment, where all the lost and condemned people will receive their degree of eternal punishment, according to Revelation 20. Now, it's going to be a time of rewards for us as believers, but there's also going to be some solemn rebukes. Even Billy Graham and John Wesley and Jonathan Edwards, they're going to have to go. I mean, all these great men of faith are going to be surprised with what they're going to be judged by. I mean, why do you think there's going to be so many tears in heaven? Lost opportunities. Lost opportunities. We're free, folks. But with that freedom comes responsibility. Some of our works are going to be like gold and silver and costly stones, according to 1 Corinthians. But others are going to be like wood, hay, and straw. And all of our lives are going to be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each of our work. And according to the bogus work or the work that we maybe should have done or didn't or whatever, when you look at 1 Corinthians 3:15, it says, if anyone's work is burned up, he'll suffer loss, but he himself will be saved as through fire. Some Christians are going to get to heaven by the skin of their teeth, praising God still, while others that we wouldn't even think are going to get great rewards that we're going to be able to just lay at the feet of the Savior.
Yes.
Okay? A lot of people, it's going to be like a person fleeing their burning home to watch everything they worked for just turn to ashes. Jesus warned us about a bogus faith that does righteous acts, such as being baptized just to be seen by others, going to church just because that's the place to go, just to be seen. But look at the result, according to Matthew 6, verse 1. Beware of practicing your righteousness before others to be seen by them. Otherwise, you have no reward from your Father in heaven. Man, that's tough. James concludes, he says, because judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Mercy triumphs over judgment.
Yes, it does. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
A deeper evil revealed in this verse. Favoritism is evidence of an unmerciful heart.
Say that again.
Favoritism is evidence of an unmerciful heart. So, at the judgment seat of Christ, we'll be judged on how we judge others. But if we're merciful and do not show favoritism, we got a great promise. According to Matthew 5, verse 7, blessed are the merciful, for they shall be what? Shown mercy. Shown mercy. Now, I have to admit, for a while I fell into that trap. You know, I can remember when I first got called into ministry, after I fought that fire, because, you know, how dare God save a drug dealer and call him into the ministry, or a drug addict? Mm-hmm. You know, how dare God do that? Well, that's not my problem, that's God's problem. But that was a different story. You know, I'll never forget, I had one lady when I went to when I did my licensing message, she told the pastor that if I wore my earring, she would get up in the middle of my sermon and leave.
Wow. Holy cow.
I should have wore it, Dan.
You should have.
But I didn't because Lee Holland, our friend, he said, man, don't start out like this. You got enough crap ahead of you. Don't start out. And I'm glad I did, but part of me is just like, I should have.
Showing her heart.
But it's okay. Because afterwards, she comes up to Kim and said, I'm not worried. It's going to be okay. So was it worth it? Yeah. It was worth it.
Right.
It was worth it. But little did I know, okay, that when we got to seminary, we thought that, man, it was just, we were just going to have a bunch of kumbaya meetings and it was going to be awesome. Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, the first week, one of the students tried to run over his wife with the car because she was sleeping with the guy she met there in Kansas City in their apartment on campus. First week. Then I think there was the guy who took the gun in the woods and was shooting the gun, and the army of KC police showed up. Remember that? And then Kim had to quit her job because we couldn't get anybody to watch Miles and Mia 15 minutes a day between the time she got home and I had to go to work.
Wow.
We were blessed by that. And that started us off. And then, I could go on and on and on, but and the closer we get to the return of Christ, the more we're going to see a divided body of believers.
Yep.
Our brother Devin, we've got to know, who's doing the Trail of Joy thing, He said it the best. He said, you know, our churches need to be unified. And he said, you know what? If a church would pick up on a Sunday morning and go to another church, mm-hmm, and worship with them, both churches would grow.
That'd be good.
That blew me away. But it makes sense. I mean, I've always in the last 15 years, I've always believed that, you know, we've got more in common than we don't. And we're worried about the wrong things. We were watching this little gal today, this morning. We couldn't even watch it all. Once again, I mean, she was dogging the Word of Faith people. You know, yeah, they've done some crazy things. Probably not all of them biblical. But then again, you know, the ultra-conservatives haven't done everything biblical either.
Amen.
You know? I'm sorry, if you stick your nose up in the air, you just smell the stench a little bit faster. You know? And I'm just kind of like, dang, what is wrong with us? Because, you know, because we've got so much in common, and Christianity is the only religion being attacked. Which you know, Jesus prophesied over, and so did many of the other Old Testament prophets too. You know, why is it just us? Maybe it's because we have the truth and they don't. And so now, I mean, the attacks on each other are just ridiculous. It's almost as if it's the attack flavor of today. I mean, it's all bitter and sour. It is. But we, you know,
same strategy to
it is
stop the power of God.
But the biggest issue though, Ken, is in America we as believers have gotten lazy. We're not in our word. We're expecting our pastors to do all the work for us.
Yes, sir.
And then when we don't get our blessings the way we think we should, then it's all your fault, Ken.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Word for compromise.
There is compromise. It's worse than that, though.
Pride.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, you know, we wonder why pastors are dropping like flies. And have serious health problems. Mm-hmm. And basically are going more nuts than they already are. Well, that's the big issue. And that's why I believe persecution is coming. Because we have compromised our faith.
Mm. Both directions.
But that's think that's one of the big reasons. But in history it has been shown that when the Christians are persecuted, it grows.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when it's comfortable, it dies.
Mm-hmm. Let us grow, Jesus.
Let us grow, Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
And that, I mean, that's why it's coming. But we still win in the end.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if they take our lives, you know, so I'm going to be with eternity in Jesus in heaven, where there is no sickness, no disease, and no stinking climate change.
Amen.
Maybe God will let me have my gas stove. You know, yeah, you know, pure water coming from the throne of heaven. You know, I mean, come on, please. Now, does it mean that I'm going to go, happy, joy, come get me? No, that's stupid. But, I mean, it's coming, folks. But that's okay. It's okay. Because I know in the end, when it's all said and done, and I've laid what few crowns that Jesus has given me for the works that I've done back at his feet.
Amen.
It's all going to be okay. So, maybe we as a body of believers here who have seen what the folly of favoritism is, knowing that it is snobbish and silly and sinful and short-sighted, the letter S, you know, woo-hoo. You know, but if we see it, maybe we can be the ones who break the cycle.
Yes, sir.
Before it's too late.
Yes.
Because the bottom line is this. I mean, you know, when Jesus was on the cross, he died for all of us. He died for Lutherans and Catholics and Baptists and Charismatics and everybody. He died for everybody. And I don't see anywhere in Scripture where it says, I just died for thou Baptists.
Right.
You know, I just died for thou Charismatics. I don't see that anywhere in Scripture.
No.
And I've asked over and over, how many people believe every word in the Bible? And everybody's, the first thing you say is, I do. Well, do you? If you do, then don't be a snob.
Amen.
Walk them up. Amen.
Just love them. And then go home and say your favorite deacon words because you have to sometimes. Then conclude with, Lord, forgive me for my temper.
Change my heart.
And bless those folks.
Amen.
In a way that they can only say it came from God.
Amen.
And that's the key, see?
Yeah.
You know, if we start praying for blessings for even for our persecutors and for those who disagree with us, say, Lord, bless them in a way that they know that it came from you and nobody else. And if we do that, you know.
Yes. Put it in God's hands and let him know.
There you go.
Hallelujah.
He does. Abba, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, thank you so much for this word. And just watch over us and protect us. We want to thank you, Lord, that you took care of Rick's mom this week. Her surgery went well, Lord. We thank you so much for that. Thank you for answering prayers for those of us who pray.
Praise and honor, Lord, to you, Jesus. Praise your holy name,
stuff coming on the horizon, and we just pray that it be successful. And that you would be glorified. And that's it. Nothing that a human being does, let them not get any credit. But you get all the glory and honor for it.
All the glory, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' holy name. And God's people said,
Amen.
And all right, we'll be back at it next week. Lord, Lord, Lord.